everyone. Thank you for joining me on my channel, Oak House Journals, and it's Carol here. So, week 17 of the 52 tags project, and the prompt this week was to do couching stitch. Well, couching stitch is the same as a tacking stitch, but because it is a permanent stitch and it's not taken out like a tacking stitch, it's quite often a decorative stitch. It can be a plain stitch, but quite often it is made decorative. And it can be used to couch down all sorts of things. Anne used it in her project to couch down rolls of fabric, but you could couch down anything from paper, twigs, thread, other yarns, to leaves, and even other stitches. So I thought I would use my couching stitch to couch a twig again, and I have this little one that I got from the garden. I particularly like this little one because it has areas of lichen that has adhered to the twig in kind of delicate shades of yellowy green up here to greys and then greens down here. So I thought that would be quite nice to couch down onto my piece of fabric, and I'm going to couch it down on this left hand side. I also thought that I would use my couching stitch to couch down rolls of fabric. Now, I wasn't sure whether to use the same fabric as I've got here, which is one of my rusted fabrics, and this is a piece that got ripped off the project that I did in the last video. And as you can see, if I roll it up, I quite like this rough frayed edge, but if I roll it up, it will give me some nice colour variations to the fabric that would work in well with this piece. The other idea that I thought was, I have here some old scarves, and I did look at this one. Now, this is an old silk scarf which has got some nice shades of brown on it, and that's quite a nice shade of mushroom brown, which I thought might work well on this piece. And because it's so fine, it would be easy to manipulate. So that was one idea I had. And the other idea was to use, now don't laugh, this scarf. Now, this scarf is very boho. It's a silk scarf. It has some solid, rich burgundy areas, but then it has this, like, almost a sheer organza at the end. Now, I know it's not organza, it is silk, but I particularly liked it. And what really drew me to this was two things, really. This area here, which is yellowy greens, and also the beads on these silk threads. Now, I've chopped a piece off because I think I will be using this, and I think that it will roll beautifully, and also that these tiny, tiny silk threads with the beads threaded through, I think I can use those on my project to add extra interest. So I'm actually leaning towards these two rather than using this lovely shades of brown in this silk scarf. So those are what I think I will use to couch down. I also plan to couch down some stitches. Now, there is a particular stitch that I've seen used in Elizabethan embroidery that I think might be quite nice to add to this effect and for me to try this week. So I'm going to use that. So, as you can see, I'm working on a piece of my rusted fabric again. This time I'm not lining it in any way, it's just a single piece of my fabric. And as you can see, I've gone all the way around the outside with a single strand of DMC thread, and I've done a stem stitch. And that, I quite like doing that because it acts a bit like a frame to my piece. Now, these are not very big pieces that I do. It's about 2.5 inches by, I think it's probably about 4.5 or even 5 inches. So they're pretty small pieces. And I think it's quite nice to actually do that little bit of stitching around the outside to act as a frame. And I'm thinking the colours will blend quite nicely if I use, again, this rusted fabric on it and some of this organza-type silk couched onto it as well. So that's my cunning plan, and I'm going to switch off the camera now and take you along with me on my process by doing some photographs and maybe stopping from time to time to do another little video for you along the way. I think I will do a video for you showing you how I do the Elizabethan stitch that I couch down, because I think you might be interested in that. So I will be joining you soon. This is as far as I've got for the moment with this little piece. I decided not to use this piece of torn rusted fabric because when I did the rolling, I actually thought that it was going to look too heavy and chunky, and with these being such small pieces, it was too much. But I will save it, and I love this couching idea over fabric, so I will be using it again. So the obvious option was to go with that silk scarf that had all the tasseled beads. So I actually rolled it and left all the beads on with those threads and couched it meandering underneath this piece here. Now, after I couched it down, I was struggling with those beads. They were getting in the way of everything. So I actually eventually chopped them off and decided that they weren't going to do this Elizabethan stitch very well. So I chopped them off, as you can see. But I was loving how this was working and couching this down and the texture of this, that I included another piece of it, just rolled and couched it down round my twig here. Now my twig also is couched down, and I hope you're going to be able to pick this up on the camera. I've done a large area here and, sorry, large area there, another area there, and another area under this thread here, or this rolled silk fabric. And I did that in the Sue Spargo Eleganza thread and did blanket stitch to couch that down. And then there's a small area here and another one here where I just went straight over and down the other side in almost a stab stitch to hold my twig in place a little bit more securely. There is a single Suffolk puff here that I've used to add a little bit of dimension in that bottom corner. And I've started to stitch over the top of it with this Elizabethan stitch, which I'll show you in a moment. And it's super easy. And I've also started to intersperse it with some French knots because I wanted to pick up the colour up here, this gorgeous mustard goldy colour. I wanted to pick that up in the bottom here, and I was hoping that this area here on the silk fabric was going to work, but it's got lost underneath all this stitching here. You can see there's a little bit there, so I want to bring it in some more. So I'm looking at using some of these DMC threads and possibly that Stef Francis super fine silk thread. So I still got more work to do on this, but as you know, I tend to keep them fairly simple. But let me show you how I've done this Elizabethan thread. Now, you can do this in, I'm just going to bring in my, what I call my reminder hoop. This is kind of like my practice hoop. You can do this stitch in any thread that has got a twist to it. So this is perlay, a number 12 perlay, and that has got a twist to the thread. The Stef Francis mercerised cotton, this is number 16, is absolutely lovely for doing this. And this little example down here is where I've used that thread. The one I love doing it in is, again, my Sue Spargo, and this is one of the Razzle threads. And that gives, I don't know if you can pick it up, gives a beautiful sheen. So that's a little area just there. So that is the Stef Francis, that's the Sue Spargo. And then I've tried it in a wool as well to give a little bit more dimension. And then this again is the Stef Francis, but this time I've put some French knots at the top end. So let's get going and I'll see if I can show you how to do this stitch. And honestly, it's super easy, everybody. So what you need to do is get a length of your thread, now not too long, because it's easier to work with if it's not too long. And what I would suggest is that your tail, or the piece that has gone through your needle that you're not sewing with, you keep that fairly short. So I would say no more than a couple of inches. So you need to make sure that you are actually holding on to that end pretty well. Now, what I do is a quilter's knot at the end, but even though I'm doing a quilter's knot, I actually will take my thread through to the right side of my fabric. I'll go down again. Because if you don't do that extra little stitch, what will happen is your knot underneath will move. It will twizzle, and it will mean that you are not going to get the tension that you want. And just keep your eye, as I say, on this little piece of thread here, because it will want to disappear on you. Now, all you do is you look at your thread and work out which way the twist is on your thread. So the twist will be on this one is clockwise, to keep your threads tight. So that if I twisted it counterclockwise, my threads would start separating. And that is actually what you want. It gives the better effect. Now, because the camera is so low, I'm going to have to do this in my fingers. But normally what I would do is I would hold my needle and my thread taut, and I would just twist my needle. Sorry, I'm just going to get that thread down again. Twist my needle counterclockwise. But because the camera is so low, I can't do that. So what I'm going to do is I am going to start twisting counterclockwise. And as you can see, you start getting this sort of kink in your thread. Now that is exactly what you want. So I'm going to twist some more. And the bigger your threads, the more they will, you will see that they are separating. But if I hold this up to the camera, I hope you can just see, if I show you here, can you just see that those threads are separating? Now that's what you want, because that's going to give you more texture and dimension. So just keep that tension. And when you get a little twist like that, you can manipulate it and push it down your piece. Because what you want are you actually want these little random spikes. And they are what will give you your points of interest here to create what looks like moss or lichen or grass. It gives that sort of effect. And they used to use it exactly for that in Elizabethan embroidery. You see these lovely mossy banks where the animals were sitting on top. And that is exactly the look that you try and create with this. And as you can see, it's all knotting and twisting at the bottom. And you just manipulate it into the shape that you want. I'm just moving my needle out of the way there. And you can carry on doing this as much as you want. You can over twist it, so just be a little bit mindful of that. And it is easier if you twist with the needle. But as I say, you can manipulate it and bring these threads down onto your piece and get them where you want them. And I'm just going to twizzle that around a little bit. And you just literally bunch it all up to get it how you want it to look. It is fiddly, this one, but it gives you a lovely effect. Now I've got a nice little, as you can see, a little collection of those twists. And this is where the couching comes in. So you're using the rest of your thread and you're just going to go down through your work with the remainder of your thread, and you are just going to couch down those little twists. And this is where you can get the look that you want just by doing this. And as I say, the more you do this with your threads, the better the look you get. And if I wanted to, I could manipulate those and tease them so that they're all facing up in one direction. So let's do that. And all I'm doing is little stabbing stitches up and down just to hold that all in place. And then if you've got enough thread left over, you can do a little bit more. So here I'm going to make sure that thread on the other side of my needle is anchored. And I'm just going to do some more twisting. And this is where it becomes easier, I find, when you've actually got, whoops, it's just coming through there, when you've got your needle to twist with. But as I say, it's twisting at the top here for me, as you can see. But you can just kind of tease it down a little bit onto your project. So I'm just twisting. Now, I don't mind at all that the loose piece of thread, the non-stitching piece of thread, is actually twisting on my sewing thread, if you will. But what you want to do is, if that thread is too long, it will snarl, so that when you want to pull your thread through your fabric to anchor it down, you won't be able to do that. So you need to keep your eye on that. And that's why I say just have a small tail of non-sewing thread, and then it won't snarl like that. You see, I've got my twist there, so I'm just going to tease it down onto my fabric, lower down, and just work it. Just get a few more little twists down at the bottom there. As you can see, I've got some. So I'm just going to hold those in place and just do a few couching stitches. It's not rocket science, this one. It is fiddly, but it's not rocket science. And I think the effect it gives is just lovely on a project. And I'm not actually pulling the stitches that I'm making to couch it down tight. I'm leaving little loops. The odd one I'm doing tight to act as a proper couching stitch. but some of the others I'm just leaving loose. So I'm just going to come up one last time. Now what you can do, if you wanted to, I haven't got enough thread here. You could do a French knot, or you could just finish it off on the other side, as the mood takes you, really. So I'm just going to go through to the other side and thread it through my piece. Sorry, this is a very, very messy piece of, well, it's not embroidery on the reverse. As I said, it's my reminder hoop, so I don't mind how this looks on the reverse in the slightest. So let me just tighten that up a little bit for you. There we have it, everybody. It just gives these lovely textured twists on your project. And as I say, if you're doing something like a mossy bank, or you wanted to replicate grass or lichen or something like that, these are just perfect to use. So that's what I used along the bottom of my tag to get, or my piece, embroidery piece, to get that effect. All right, everybody, so I'm still going to go away and do a little bit more on this piece. I'm thinking, as I say, of doing some French knots here, introducing a little bit more of the mustard shade. Okay, I'll be back shortly. So I'm back with my finished piece, and yeah, I'm quite pleased with it this week. In terms of the suggestion that Anne made to use rolled fabric, I'm happy with that. I've hit that target, albeit that it's tucked under here and you can't see it, but you can see this little bit of rolled fabric there that I've used. And in terms of the prompt to use couching, well, I know I've hit that because I couched down the fabric. I've couched down this Elizabethan stitch, I couched down my Suffolk puff, and I've also couched down my twig up here. So I know I've hit that prompt this week. And I've also had an amazing amount of fun along the way. It's given me an opportunity to try out a new stitch, and I have to say I am loving this Elizabethan mossy stitch, as I'm calling it. And also I love this little stitch, this tiny stitch that I've done down here to try and replicate seeds, if you will, and that I've used the Danish knot for. So a big thank you to Chris for introducing me to that knot. I think it's certainly going to become one of my firm favourites, along with my French knots, and also my little bullion knots. I've done some single strand of DMC thread bullion knots just along the edge of my Suffolk puff, just there, just to couch the edge of the Suffolk puff down. So thank you so much for watching, everybody. I hope you like this week's effort from me, and roll on Friday for the new challenge. Take care, everybody. Bye bye now.